to aptly describe the essence of his soul. He can be remembered for his devotion to his church, because wherever he attended church in the various seasons of his life, he was faithful and supportive and giving and serving and doing his best to follow God and the pastor, which is also rare. But even that fails to comprehensively get to the heart of the man that we celebrate today. Yes, he will be remembered for his humor and laughter. Yes, he will be remembered for loving his family to life. Yes, he will be remembered for being devoted to every church he joined. Yes, he will be remembered as a distinguished mason and a cherished brother of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. But above all, he will be remembered for his faith. For it was his faith that allowed every piece of his life to come together. His faith fueled his laughter. His faith fueled his humor. His faith fueled his love for his family. His faith fueled his devotion to the church. His faith caused him to be a remarkable community man. He will be remembered as a man of deep faith. Yeah, faith, that thing that keeps you going when others tell you to stop. Faith, the indomitable energy of a believer that helps you hold on when your grip slips. Faith, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., is that thing that helps you take a step even when you can't see the whole staircase. Faith, Philip Yancey says, is believing in advance, which will only make sense in reverse. Faith, a hoping for and a certainty about. Faith, which will let you hope for it and be certain about it at the same time. Faith is substance and evidence. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Faith will let you get on a plane without checking the pilot's credentials. Faith will let you take medicine from a prescription you can't read or pronounce. Faith calls you to sit down on the pew you're sitting on without checking one screw underneath the pew. Faith, that word pistis in Greek, that means basically faith is a force that is forward directed and aggressive, never passive or backward reaching, but always reaching forward to obtain or achieve a specific target or goal. It is forward directed. It is forward directed. You're always reaching to obtain what you can't see, to grab what folks say you can't get. It's forward directed. Faith helps us reach forward against all odds and oppositions. Faith lets you tell the doctor, I know what you see, but I also know what he said. And that's why they can count you out years ago and you still be alive to 2018. That's why the songwriter said, we did not come this far by facts. We did not come this far by technology. We did not come this far by science. We did not come this far by logic. We did not come this far by reason. We did not come this far by education or degrees or networks or fraternities or sorority. The songwriter says, we've come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in his holy word. He ain't never failed us yet. I feel like preaching. Facts says you can't. Fear says you shouldn't. And faith says try it anyway. Facts says you can't. Fear says you shouldn't. Faith will say, I believe God is still able. Facts says you can't. Fear says you shouldn't. But faith says he was wounded for my transgression. He was bruised for my iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. But with his stripes we already healed. Facts says you can't. Fear says you shouldn't. But faith says my God will supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. And the text says, by faith, Joseph at the end of his life made mention of the exodus of the Israelites and gave instructions about his burial. This Joseph in our text is the same Joseph from the book of Genesis. He's the the dreaming Joseph. He's the color coordinated coat wearing Joseph. This is the great grandson of Abraham, the grandson of Isaac, the son of Jacob. This is Joseph. And I see some strange similarities between the faith of Joseph in our text and the faith of the Joseph that we honor today. And I'm convinced, Mama Scott, that we all ought to be striving to have this type of faith. This is that type of faith that'll give you swag even when you're sick. This is the type of faith that'll make you smile what ain't nothing to smile about. This is the type of faith that'll have you running and ain't nobody chasing you. Have you clapping and ain't nothing going on. Have you laughing and ain't nothing. This is some faith that'll hold you when life knocks the breath out of you. Oh, I believe it's the faith of Joseph. It was his faith that held him together, and it was the faith of the Joseph in the text that held him together. What is it about this faith? What is it about this faith? Three things I've done. This faith impacted how he struggled. Oh, Lord, the Joseph in the text. The Joseph in the text went through something. The text says, by faith, Joseph, which you can't appreciate this content if you don't have a clue about the context. You got to know a little bit of something about the struggle of this Joseph. He was favored by his father, but he was betrayed by his brothers, because sometimes the folk that are hurt you the most ain't your strangers or the enemy. It's the folk right up on you. This Joseph thrown in a pit. This Joseph sold into slavery. This Joseph went to Potiphar's house, got elevated because of his integrity. But this Joseph got lied on by a fast woman named Potiphar's wife. This Joseph got thrown in prison. This Joseph interpreted dreams for the prisoners. They got out and forgot about him helping them while they were all still in prison. This Joseph survived through it all and ended up as second in command in Egypt. Went through a pit, went through slavery, went through pain, went through prison, forgotten about and still made it. Went through a pit, went through slavery, lied on, went to prison, forgotten about, still made it. This Joseph went through a pit, went through slavery, lied on, went to prison, forgotten about, still made it. And the Joseph we honor today, he's been to hell and back, but he's still made it. He went through some struggles, but watch this now. It's not about are you going to go through the struggle. It's about how you're going to go through the struggle. And he decided that greater was in him than he that was in the world. He decided that the Lord would give him strength even when his body was collapsing. It ain't about are you going to go through the struggle. It's about how you're going to go through the struggle. Because all Joseph's story in the book of Genesis, it kept saying something that's going to bless your socks off. It kept saying, and the Lord was with him. Do you know you can go through anything if you know the Lord is with you? That's why half of y'all in the room are sitting there stuck and silent. It's because you ain't been through nothing. But if you go through some struggles, if you go through some trials, if you go through something and the Lord stuck with you through it, you don't need a choir, a preacher, or any music. You give God glory every day just because out of all of my struggles, he stayed with me. And he had a favorite Joseph impacted how he struggled. He struggled with some swag on fleek after strokes that could have counted him out, after surgery on the spine that had him incapacitated for days. Faith of Joseph impacts how you struggle, but that doesn't impact how you struggle, it also impacts how you speak. Because the text says, by faith, Joseph, at the end of his life, made mention, talked about the exodus of the children of Israel. You got to understand this. Joseph made it to Egypt and was able to save his whole family, known as the children of Israel, but when he died in Egypt. Heard his great-granddaddy or his granddaddy, Abraham and Isaac, talking about some promised land that God was going to give the children of Israel. So even as he was dying, he still believed what God said. And so what he said matched what God said, even when he wouldn't see what God said was going to happen. that he would never live to see. The Exodus wouldn't take place until about 4 centuries later, 400 years later, but as he was dying, he was convinced that God would take his people to a promised land. Oh, when you got some faith like Joseph, you talk different. If you want to believe if somebody's a real Christian, just walk out and watch how they talk. Because when you got some faith, you talk different. And Joseph Scott talked different. Let me tell you about how he talked. In 2015, when I was a young pastor, just turned 24 years old, he came to me and said, "Hey, Ray, if you are struggling or this church is struggling, ask us for money. Because all of us got it, it's just about what we want to spend it on. What man do you know goes to the pastor to say, ask us for money, when most men leave the church because they are asking for money?" He talked different. 2015, after his kidney didn't work, he called me and I called to check on him, bringing him up to Emory, met up with Miss Jamison in London, Emory, and he told me, although his body was collapsing and the kidney he was waiting on for over 7 years, his body rejected it. He said, "I told the Lord I can't die yet because I got to help you build the foundation of this church." My last Sunday was the first Sunday of June. He died 3 months and 1 day after I left. And today I believe he's playing a low-key practical joke, because it's the 8th of September. Everything that he wanted is completed. But he stopped. 2017, after he was waiting on another kidney, he said, "Sean, let me tell you something, Ray. I believe I'm going to get a kidney. I'm going to wait 3 months. And if I don't get it in 3 months, I'm going to believe the next 3 months I'll get it. And if I don't get it that 3 months, I'm going to believe the next 3 months I'll get it. And if I don't get it in those 3 months, I'm going to believe that y'all ain't listening." He spoke differently. In 2018, just a couple Sundays ago, he was at his lowest on the first Sunday of August. And his last words to his wife and daughter while he was still talking was, "Go to church and serve."
Because it's cooked a little differently.
They told us to bring ammonium, but I didn't understand why they were telling me that. Until the last night in Cuba, I got sick. The last night, I was on a trip away from home, and I got sick. And I knew that the ammonium I packed wasn't going to be enough to minister to what was going on. Until I got back home. I'm glad I got sick near the end of the trip because I was close to home. I got sick on the trip, but it all got better when I got back home. 64 years ago, June 15, Joseph Anson Scott came down here to take a trip. And I'm so glad he wasn't sick the whole trip, but near the end of the trip, he got sick away from home. But God knew, even though he got sick on the trip down here to earth, it would all be fixed when he got back home. Because he's gonna sleep differently. He's resting now. As my brother Scott the walls surround the city. Home, where the gates are trimmed with priceless pearls. Home, where the streets are paved with gold. Home, where God shall wipe every tear from our eyes. Home, where the wicked shall cease from troubling and the weary shall be at rest. Home, where there are no more goodbyes. Home, where there's no more home, where there's no more congestive heart failure. Home, where there's no more dialysis 3 times a week. He's going home, where there's no more cancer or hypertension. He's going home, where all blood pressure levels will be regulated. Home, where there's no more handicapped parking spots. He's going home, where there's no more canes, walkers, or wheelchairs. Where the sun never stops shining, and the eternal winds never stop blowing, and the angels never stop singing. He's headed to rest in the promised land. It's a holy land. It's a peaceful land. Joseph, you'll meet up with Joseph, you'll meet up with